question, which was that what's interesting is, Mike, you transitioned from municipal to provincial.
Right.
And you transitioned from provincial to municipal. So we already know why you transitioned. So what was the driving force behind you going from mayor to premier?
Frustration again. You know, I was really frustrated with the shortbread government at the time, which is a typical thing for a Vancouver mayor to be. We had the Agricultural Land Commission being systemically dismantled. And Bill Banner's now, pushing that, and so it was really frustrating to have to deal with a government that didn't get the livable region strategy, the livable region plan for the whole region, but the green zone was absolutely essential, the protection of farmland, significant ecological areas of watersheds, and that the livable region plan idea of 70% being in a green zone and the other 30% urban based, but even then to have town centers linked by public transit rather than freeways, and to have complete communities so you could live, work, play in the same place. And that was being systemically cut away. And I remember one vote, they spent it for a farm vote out in Delta, where the idea was to subdivide it into those huge lots, monster houses, and destroy this perfectly fine old, really high-grade farmland. And it came to a vote of the regional district, and the vote was 33-32, turned down. And I was glad to be votes 31, 32, and 33 to turn that down. Well, the result was that the Socrates and the MIF state eliminated the regional planning function. So if you can't plan anymore, and you can't call your planners planners, so we call them development officers. And we just defied them and kept planning the regional district. But that's a hard way to fight, and so I decided to take a demotion and go from being mayor of Vancouver to being premier. and to take on Bill Batterson, who was a maniac. I don't remember the time, right? And you knew he was going to implode. It's like Donald Trump. You just know what's going to happen. And so I ran for for the provincial legislature, and really hard riding when the NDP only got 70% of the vote in Vancouver Center, as it was then known, and got elected. And so that kind of got me started provincially to then try and end the war in the woods, to try and make sustainable cities a major part of the province's role to be cooperative. So I was ready to get stuff done, and frustration then got me out of city politics and demoted to provincial politics.
A demotion. I'm wondering, how do you both feel about the strength of the region right now in terms of, do we have work to do to get back to that place of planning together as a region? Because, what is, in this time of growing population moving to cities, what is the role, what is the greater role of regional politics?
Well, I'd say we enjoy more shared objectives as a region than we ever had. And there's been ups and downs over the years with Metro Vancouver, or GVRD, as it was called before. Right now, just a couple of years ago, we approved a regional growth strategy together. So we basically entrenched all this legacy of planning work and protecting the green zones and designating the high growth areas. That work was all approved as a region, which was unprecedented to the depth that it exists now. We have a 10-year transit plan as a mayor's council, which was created through provincial legislation, has actually turned into, I think, quite a constructive body to work with the transit board and actually plan the transportation kind of in alignment with the land use that we do at Metro Vancouver and then individually as local governments. So I think we're at a time where there's way more in common and there's consensus on some really critical pieces that I think evade many, many big cities, many metro areas around the world. We still have issues to resolve, but our biggest challenges are dealing with the province, frankly, and making sure they come to the table with transit investment and they come to the table with broader infrastructure investment. The two sewer plants desperately need improvement. Lionsgate and Iona are pretty deplorable for this day and age. Not that, and, you know, Victoria CRD has their problems as well. But, and we have Mr. Floaty on the island to fix that. But we're still faced with this enormous backlog in investing in urban infrastructure. And it's just not been a priority for provincial governments for many years now. And we had hoped that this year we'd see, prior to the election, that we'd see more commitment. Also leveraged by the Trudeau government, who put a lot more skin in the game from a federal perspective. And we're really thankful. Trudeau basically won his majority through the cities of Canada.
Yep.
So it's really finally the cities being organized and voting in members of parliament who want to see investment in our cities, know that that's where almost all Canadians live now, and where our economy is growing robustly. So, but having the provincial government lag has been difficult. And I would say at the metro table, regardless of our personal political stripes, there's a lot of disappointment that we haven't seen more investment in our infrastructure, and that extends into affordable housing. Way behind the eight ball. Homelessness is worse than ever. We just came out as mayors and regional directors. We approved a homelessness paper that we advanced to the provincial government. Right now we have about 85 tent encampments around the region. The problem has always been more focused and centralized in Vancouver, but now it's spread all over the region. People living outside all over. We'll have the count in a couple of weeks that was done at the beginning of March, but we basically had unanimous support calling on the province for 1,000 units a year of transitional housing, like modular housing or buying hotels, anything to get people inside off the streets, and a much more robust approach to get everyone into affordable housing that's on the waiting list right now. So that, just as an example, we're all together on this. Mm-hmm. As a region, which is, as Mike can attest to, I'm sure, is very difficult to do, given the diversity here, but we're not seeing the support that we need from the BC government, and the federal government is improving. We're seeing signs of life there, and hopefully this federal budget advances that in the next week.
Mike, any thoughts on that?
Well, I agree with Gregor. I think there is a remarkable consensus amongst the mayors of the region, and we've done two things right, I think, over the last while. One is to re-energize the inner city of Vancouver, where we now have about 100,000 to 150,000 people living in the inner city. 76% of them don't take a car to work. You know, so you get people walking, cycling, taking public transit, and you get that virtuous combination. But Surrey is no longer having to say, "I'm Surrey." You know, they've got their act together. And even though I don't agree with Diane Watts politics, I think she did a remarkable job as mayor of doing what you also have to do to become a sustainable urban area. You have to re-energize your inner city and reinvent suburbia. And they've done a really good job of that in Surrey and in the other suburban areas of Greater Vancouver. So we've got the right metrics in place. And it's worldwide this is happening. I mean, we just a quick snapshot of the world population. There was it took to 1800 for the first billion people to come on the planet. By 1930, there were 2 billion. By 2000, there were 6 billion. Half living in cities, 3 billion people living in cities for the first time. There are now over 7 billion, and by 2050, there'll be 10 billion people on the planet. 7 billion of them live in cities. Now, get those figures. That's how we are becoming what I call homo urbanus. We're becoming an urban species, and cities are where it's at. In Canada, as Gregor said, basically 95% of Canadians live in 9 big cities and 110 median size. Some live in the inner city, some live in the suburbs, and some live in what I call the rubers. In other words, the unorganized areas just beyond paying taxes in the city. But that's Canada now, hugely urbanized. And that's what's happened, the acceleration of people in cities in China, India, throughout Africa. And so getting cities right is really important. And the kind of experimentation that's happening here in Vancouver is still relevant. I mean, there's a term, Vancouverism, which is the form of development that we have, not just in Vancouver, but throughout the region, that is key. And I think the province is the linchpin. It has to be at the table cooperatively, has to be there and cohesively, right from the beginning. Not doing ad hoc decisions like that really dumb idea of a transit plebiscite. You have a plebiscite for transit, but then you go ahead and unilaterally build the Portland Bridge. And now it's an even dumber idea, which is the Massey Bridge. So you can let LNG tankers go up the crazy river. Pretty good idea, right? Well, you are already, I talked to Kevin Falcon, this is already earthquake-proofed. The existing tunnel in 2006. So why wouldn't you just fix that up a little bit more and then punch another six lanes with two for transit and a bike? Anyway, so you need the province to be there, but I'll close by saying the federal government doesn't get off the hook because one of the worst public policy decisions ever made in this country was in 1994 when the federal liberals got rid of the nonprofit housing program. Terrible decision. Because they were building 25,000 nonprofit co-op housing units a year in Canada with the nonprofit program brought in 1973-4 for 20 some odd years. And then Ballmark and Zappel, and he was wrong in this one, got rid of it as getting rid of the deficit. So we have over 550,000 units of affordable housing that could be built over the last 20 some odd years that haven't been built. So you wonder why we got an affordability problem? So the federal government has to get back in that game and start aggressively working with provinces and cities in the private sector in this region to build affordable supply. I mean, you can have all the data demand with, you know, foreign buyer taxes and empty housing prohibitions or taxes, but building affordable supply is the key. So the federal government's got to get in. The province has to be the linchpin, and cities stay active and cooperating, like Gregor says. If we're going to deal with affordable housing, build out the transit system, fix the infrastructure for sewage treatment and these other very essential urban infrastructure issues we still have to address. Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about housing since you brought it up. So both of you have had to deal with major housing concerns during your times as mayor. Maybe how do you think the issues that you were dealing with in your time compared to the issues today? And then Gregor, we'll get you to get your thoughts on some of Mike's legacies around housing and how the city is currently working to address the housing affordability issues.
Well, we had as we do now, probably the most activist city council and staff in trying to get affordable housing built. And we used to do 1,000, 2,000 units a year of nonprofit co-op housing in False Creek on the south side, for example, by Gravel Island. Champlain Heights was city-owned land, and 100 other sites throughout the city that we made available to nonprofit co-op groups at half the market value, broken down on a leasehold basis, and then green-lighted them, lowered the parking requirements, did everything we could to make all families, and we built it in to the south side of Falls Creek, west of the Candy Bridge, and into Champlain Heights, and all of the housing was a mixture of incomes, deep subsidies for low-income people, for the federal provincial governments. And so I think we've got that history again. We built 20,000 some odd nonprofit co-op housing units from 1974 to 1994. Just think of the number of people that are desperate for housing that we could have housed over the last 20 years that we haven't. And I think that's terrible because of it's hurting the green economy. It's hurting the high-tech. We talked about the high-tech entrepreneurs. They'll tell you, we cannot keep and attract young people. We can't keep and attract talent because of the high cost of housing, the lack of affordable child care, the lack of mobility and transportation, students, you know, coming out of post-secondary institutions, huge debt loads. So how do they afford a down payment to buy a house, even if they could afford it, you know, live in the city of Vancouver? So we've got some really serious challenges that we have met in the past with the cooperation of federal provincial governments and a very skilled nonprofit co-op housing development sector and a very capable private sector development community that we have in Vancouver. So we've got to get back to that.
Yeah. Yep.
Absolutely agree. It's the challenge we have now is just, you know, 2 decades of backlog of not building anywhere near enough affordable housing to meet the demand, and that's that coupled with just constant population growth. I mean, and that's, you know, we're kind of a victim of our own success here. We have one of the world's most livable cities and an economy that's booming because it's very diverse. Because again, leadership. For decades now, going back to film and television, and Mike and the team making sure that was a top priority in the 80s, the BC government following through there, and building the creative industries from scratch here over decades to now being, you know, one of the most potent hubs in the world, number one in the world for visual effects and animation, which is thousands and thousands of creative jobs in Vancouver. We're attracting more people. So. It's difficult for people to hang on and afford to live here, in large part because more people keep coming with more money to the good jobs that we're creating here. So we're in a vicious cycle, which is only addressable if we continue to increase the supply. We're building record levels of housing now. For the last several years, 3 years in a row, we're record levels of approvals at City Hall, and it's not stemming the tide, right? You know, it's not enough. And the housing that we're building doesn't have the affordability that it needs to have because the federal and provincial government aren't contributing. They basically chopped most of the housing funding that used to exist right out of their budgets and years ago and never quite replaced it. We've had some successful partnerships with the provincial government. We got 15 supportive housing projects built, targeted for homeless people. And that got most of the chronic homeless people off the streets of Vancouver in these last 5 years. But more keep coming. Every year, more keep coming. Last the count a year ago, we had a majority of the people counted as being homeless less than a year. So they're just showing up here from around the province, or they're getting booted out of buildings that are being redeveloped. So we've got all sorts of inherent challenges and pressures in the system. I'd say that the overall frustration is that there isn't an overarching commitment from our federal and provincial governments to say we're hands-on, we're going to deal with the housing problem, particularly in Vancouver and Toronto, where it's the toughest situation. And you know, instead of very modest programs targeted at maybe some homeless people here, maybe the odd bit of rent supplements there. We're not getting an overarching commitment that we need right now to address housing generally. And that means we went for years without proper regulations in the real estate market, federally and provincially. They just let the market go absolutely berserk here in Vancouver. It's still going berserk in Toronto. And the federal government's taken some action to deal with the CRA loopholes that people have manipulated, that encourage flipping and speculation and holding land and property as business investments versus homes. The province has started to weigh in the game, but all this came after the value of real estate, you know, absolutely through the roof, completely leaving behind the average income of a Vancouverite. So now we're faced with, if you want to buy a place, it's in the stratosphere. That's completely out of reach for most people here now. And we just have to focus on getting rental housing built, a huge supply of rental housing. So the supply that we do focus on now, and we're right in the middle of rejigging everything, resetting what we do at City Hall to focus on our rapid transit nodes in particular, our arterials that have good transit, our mixed multifamily neighborhoods where we have three-story walk-ups and multi-unit buildings, and city land. We have some city land that we can put into play as city councils have done over the years, but now we've got to catch up. We've got to do more, and that we can get much more affordable because the land is public. But now we're talking about single-family home neighborhoods, which, you know, it's the reality is it's the majority of the land base here. And even though we've said every single-family home is three units now, a secondary suite and laneway house is possible at every parcel of single-family home. They're all three-unit parcels, but it's not enough. And we don't have, we have neighborhoods like Carisdale, for example, emptying out 800 people, fewer in Carisdale than 5 years ago, when the rest of the city is struggling with growth. So we have to figure out how we get some thoughtful, gentle density into those neighborhoods, particularly close to the schools, because our school population in some neighborhoods has been dropping. In other neighborhoods, it's going up, but we have to be sure we're everywhere that we can get more affordable housing options. It's getting that supply and making sure it's targeted to the people who live and work and are growing up and want to build careers in the city. It has to actually fit with the people who are here versus just letting anything go and you end up with empty monster homes in some of the neighborhoods and neighborhoods that are hollowing out as a result. So we have to be much more hands-on with what we do at City Hall. And we collectively have to push a lot harder on the BC government and the federal government to say you have to invest more to improve the affordability and to regulate real estate markets here. Those are the roles of those governments.
So we've talked a lot about you know, what's happening here in the city, but how do you think that the city of Vancouver is holding leadership on the global stage right now? Where are we making a difference, and where are there opportunities for us to push further?
Well, that's a really good question, because I think one of the hidden strengths of Vancouver is the way we have evolved from quite a terrible history of mistreatment of the Aboriginal people, systemic colonial mistreatment is a plate word for it, actually. And the way that we treated the Chinese, Indo-Canadian, and other minority communities, and in turn the Japanese community in war. So we've come from a poor Jewish community not allowed to live in the British properties or join the Vancouver Club or join Chauncey Golf Course. And so we've got to acknowledge that history. However, having said that, I think over the last many decades, we have become a symbol of you can change these terrible attitudes towards people that are different than you. And work hard at relishing and appreciating people of different religions, people with different cultural backgrounds, and trying hard to make it work. Not perfectly, but I think far better than a lot of other areas of the world are, like the U.S. right now, and certain parts of Europe. And I think that is something I think are a symbol of how you can have people from diverse backgrounds to be able to share a community. and respect each other. And I think that's going to become more and more and more important in this really increasingly challenging world that we're in. And you can either sit back and wring your hands and say, isn't it terrible that this happened like that? Or you can fight and set an example that shows the difference. And frankly, I think it's cold-blooded in terms of economic well-being. We're going to attract a heck of a lot of people that are scared to move to certain parts of Europe and certain areas in the United States. And it's going to, I think, increase our ability, even with the problems of affordable housing and some of these other issues we have, to attract the best talent in the world. Richard Florida calls it the creative class. It's much broader than that, but I think that built-in reality of most Vancouverites being proud of working hard at understanding people with quite different views of the world, quite different ways of worshiping, quite different ethnic backgrounds. And I think that's a huge strength, particularly with the growth of the high-tech industries, either in life sciences or in, as Gregor said, in information technology, movies, videos, animation, clean energy. There's over 100,000 people now working in high-tech in British Columbia, 75,000, I think, alone in Vancouver. That could be doubled. And if we could deal with the terrible problem of affordable housing, affordable child care, and I think we should start setting some targets for those, and really highball on building out the transportation system, and deal with student debt and post-secondary education, and maybe treat, the way Bernie Sanders said, you know, that post-secondary education is like high school, it used to be free, right? Maybe we should look on the first degree as the same as getting a high school degree 20 years ago. So there's some creative thinking that we need to do. But I think the hidden strength of Vancouver isn't its livability. We know that. And it's part of the problem of why another 2 million people want to move to Vancouver in the next 40, 50 years. And how do we accommodate that? But respect and appreciation of diversity and the ability, in quite a ruthless way, to exploit the fact that people are scared to move to certain parts of the United States and Europe would want to come here. We should build that into our strategy.
Yeah. We're lucky to have people like Mike talking about Vancouver all over the world, and lots of Vancouverites that travel and who are leaders here and are able to tell a story about our city. And I would say this piece of multicultural, and it's beyond just tolerant or inclusive, I'd say it's very accepting and becoming very understanding between cultures in Vancouver. There's still, you know, we never take it for granted. We still, you know, we still have issues like hoax bomb threats at the Jewish Community Center. You know, these things are still with us, but so every day we've got to show up for this, and I think the work to be a city of reconciliation is about first and foremost recognizing our First Nations and making sure that they are you know, front and center with what we do here in the city on their unceded homelands, and also weaving all these other cultures together in stronger ways. And that's a really important part of who we are as a city. And it's very unusual around the world. If you travel, you don't see it in very many cities around the world, which is something that we should be sharing. And certainly, I think many cities around the world take a notice. What are we doing here in Vancouver? But the other piece that I think is very influential globally right now is the fact that we are a city that has grown enormously, population and economic success, and at the same time we've dramatically reduced our environmental impact. And that's a piece that some other cities have achieved this measure of success. In Scandinavia, some Stockholm, Copenhagen, Oslo are examples of cities that have done that. Some German cities are on that track now. But Vancouver is a superstar in that regard. And there are many cities around the world, particularly in Asia and Africa right now, that are looking at this and going, in Asia, it's too late. They've already completely polluted and destroyed the environment. In many of the cities across Asia, there's hope that African cities are going to leapfrog, much as they have with cell phones. They won't ever get dragged into the industrial activity that has swept the rest of the cities of the world and degraded the environment. They may go straight from where they are today to all renewable energy and transit and system, urban systems that are clean and green. So there's a lot of sharing happening between cities right now. The networks are very strong. Mike does a lot of this work with Quest, with the energy systems in cities, basically making sure that as cities grow, they adopt the best technology, they get to renewable. And our part of our goal to be the greenest city in the world was also to say to other cities, you know, that we're throwing down the challenge. It's a very friendly and cooperative challenge, but it has created among a whole group of cities, at least 20 or so cities right now, that are very competitive about being first to market with clean technologies, green buildings. We are one of the cities that are competing in that, and that's now a feedback loop to more economic success. It's creating all these great jobs in Vancouver, exporting our technology and our great ideas that we're implementing in our city. So the overall challenge with that again is that the more success we have being a livable city and growing and creating all of these jobs and getting along as people, means more people want to come here. So the magnitude of the challenge just continues to build, and that gives us more and more work to do. But I think that's with the cities that track us around the world, and we are constantly sharing information with other cities. SFU has actually been a great help in helping us to package and distribute what we've done as a city over generations, and what we're doing right now to help other cities, because there's a lot of learning that's taking place, and that's an important responsibility that I think we have as a city to share how we've done this and what we need to do from here. But we have a lot of work to do to keep on top of that. And in situations like affordable housing, we're losing. We have people sleeping outside tonight. 1,000, 2,000 people around the region, maybe, that are sleeping outside. So we still haven't nailed it. We still have some hard work to do. But we're a leading city, and we get a lot of attention globally for that. And we need to keep living up to that.
Thank you.